starting today. And for a total of 5 Sundays, we are going to talk about the 5 solas of the Reformation, of the Protestant Reformation. You may ask, what are the 5 solas? If you went back to the first few generations of the Protestant Reformation back in the 16th century, and you went to Martin Luther or John Calvin or Zwingli, and you said, tell me about the 5 solas, they would look at you and be like, I have no idea what you're talking about. Okay? But because they never said, well, these are 5 solas of the Reformation. Rather, historians and theologians looking back at the Protestant Reformation see that there are 5 themes, 5 things that characterize the theology of the reformers back in the 16th century. And these 5 things all begin with the word sola. You know what the word sola means, as in solo, like you have a choir and then a guy comes out and sings on his own. That's solo. He's doing a solo because he's by himself. He's alone. All right? So that's what solo or sola means, alone. And so these 5 phrases, these 5 themes that characterize the Protestant Reformation are these. I'll give them to you and then explain them to you real quick. Sola Scriptura, sola fide, sola gratia, solus Christus and soli Deo Gloria. What do those mean? Sola fide means faith alone, which means that we are justified before God through faith alone. Sola gratia, by the grace of God alone. Solus Christus, through Christ alone. Soli Deo Gloria, to the glory of God alone. Those are 4. And those 4 kind of go together. Those 4 are all about salvation. But then there's 1 on its own, sola scriptura, which has to do with authority, which has to do with what are our beliefs based upon. What is the ultimate authority when it comes to what it is that we believe as Christians? And sola scriptura, scripture alone, means that Scripture is our only infallible, inerrant, without mistakes, without errors, source of authority that we have in matters of faith and practice. Sola Scriptura does not mean that we throw out all of church history, we throw out everything that any good Christian or any council may have said, we throw out everything that was said before us, all traditions, all everything. It does not mean that. It simply means that those things are not our ultimate authority. It does not mean that we ignore authorities such as the church or elders or pastors or things like that. But all of those things that I just mentioned, traditions, councils, pastors, churches, confessions of faith, all of these things may be good, but all of these things can also make mistakes. All of these things can err. Unlike Scripture, which being the Word of God, cannot make mistakes. In John 17, Jesus, speaking to the Father, said, "Your word is truth." In Titus chapter 1, it says, "God cannot lie." And since Scripture is the very Word of God, it is the only source of authority that we have which cannot make mistakes and therefore is above all other authorities. It doesn't mean that we throw out all other authorities and everything else, but everything else is under the authority of Scripture. Everything else is subject to the ultimate authority, which is Scripture. Okay, that is what sola scriptura is. That is one of the foundations of our faith. It is one of the 5 solas of the Reformation. That is the one we're going to be talking about today. Sola scriptura. Scripture alone being the only inerrant, without error, authority that we have. From the beginning, when God first gave Scripture, first five books to Moses, Genesis to Deuteronomy, God let the people of Israel know that you are not to add to his word or take away from his word. Let me read to you Deuteronomy chapter 4. You don't have to turn there right now because I'm going to be mentioning a number of verses. We'll go to one at the end. But Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. Now, O Israel, listen to the statutes and the judgment which I teach you to observe, that you may live and go in and possess the land which the Lord God of your fathers is giving you. You shall not add to the word which I command you, nor take from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. From the beginning, he gave him five books, and he says, this is it, don't add or take away. If anyone's going to add, that's going to be God. If God decides to speak more and give us more books, which he did, that is perfectly his prerogative. But we do not add what we think God should say or what we think God means. Did the Israelites listen? No. And little by little, just a little bit of adding there, and a little bit of adding here, year after year, century after century, and we reach the time of Christ, and Judaism has become quite different from what it was originally intended centuries earlier. We reach the time of Christ in the Gospels. We're told of this one story in the Gospel of Mark, it's chapter 7, where one of the traditions that the Jews had created was that when you ate food, you had to ceremonially cleanse and wash your hands in a certain way before you ate. And now Jesus and his disciples were not following that, and they're eating without doing what the Pharisees expected them to do. And they go to Jesus and they say, why are your disciples eating without having ceremonially cleansed your hands correctly? And he says, you hypocrites, you, Isaiah the prophet prophesied about you, people who are close to God with their mouths, but in their hearts they're far from them. Why? Because you teach as doctrines commandments of men. And then he accuses them and he says, through your traditions you have nullified, you have made void the word of God. We have made void the word of God. How? Why? Because when you have the word of God up here, above everything else, and everything else is down there and is subject to the word of God, once you elevate your ideas and your thoughts and your traditions to the same level as the word of God, this isn't special anymore. This is just one more voice among all of these voices. It's just one more statement amongst in this sea of statements that, if God said this and God said that and God said that, the word of God is of no effect anymore. It doesn't matter anymore because we have all these other things that are supposed to be on the same level as the word of God, thus nullifying the word of God. Now, many in the early church, in the early Christian church, many understood this, thankfully. And if you do study church history, you will find many in the early centuries of the church, first, second, third century, fourth century, who understood that our ultimate authority is Scripture and Scripture alone, that everything else is subject to that. The early church understood the words of Jesus. They understood the words of Revelation 22 at the end, which again says not to add to his word or take away from it. But same thing happened with the Christian church that had happened with the Jews. Little by little. Add a little bit here, add a little bit there, year after year, century after century. And after a while, you have a Christianity which is very different from the way Christianity was originally. Let me take you to the 16th century, to the time of the Reformation. We all know a few things about Martin Luther. In the 16th century, something that the Roman Catholic Church was doing is that they were selling indulgences. What are indulgences? Indulgences are the Pope would grant remission of punishment. According to Roman Catholic doctrine, when you die, you go to purgatory to be cleansed of your sins and so forth for, could be for a long time. And so, according to Roman Catholic doctrine, the Pope, if you do certain good works, the Pope can grant you grace. Can grant you such grace so that you do not have to spend too much time in purgatory. And in the 16th century, you had the Roman Catholic Church selling indulgences, selling these grants that give money to the church, and therefore the Pope will grant you time out of purgatory. And Martin Luther, of course, had a huge problem with this. And he decided to object to this, and he wrote a long list of objections to the Roman Catholic system, known as the 95 Theses, 95 positions in which he disagreed with a number of things, specifically having to do with indulgences in this whole Roman Catholic system. Now, he was still a good Roman Catholic. He wasn't trying to create a protest against Roman Catholicism. He wasn't trying to break off or anything like that, but he had some problems with some of the practices of the Roman Catholic Church. And so he nails this thing on the door of this church, which was like a bulletin board. And he wrote it in Latin. Why did he write it in Latin? Because he wanted to have a scholarly academic debate on this subject. He wanted other professors and other scholars to all get together and discuss any of these 95 theses. Here's the problem, that something happened that he was not expecting. Many of the students at the university there read that and they were like, this is very interesting. So they took it down, they translated it into German, to the common language, and they went and they printed it out using the modern invention of the printing press, and suddenly the 95 Theses is spread all over Germany in the common language, which was not what Martin Luther was intending or expecting. And so now, something that was going to be a closed academic debate has become a national issue. And Martin Luther has become well known. So, Rome now has to deal with this. So what do? In the next year, in 1518, they decide to send one of the greatest theologians that the Roman Catholic Church had. You don't have to remember these names. His name was Cardinal Cajetan, and he was one of the highest theologians of the Roman Catholic Church. And they said, we're going to have a meeting with Martin Luther. Martin Luther was excited because he thought, great, I'm going to get together with one of the greatest theologians and discuss theology. So he shows up at the meeting, and to his surprise, they say to him, now, when you meet the cardinal, you are to say one word and leave. And the one word is revoco. I recant. And that's end of the discussion. And he said, I thought we were going to have a theological discussion here. And they said, no. You say revoco, and that's it. So he is taken before the cardinal. And the cardinal says, do you have anything to say, my son? And he replies, have I erred? Have I made a mistake? Yes, you have. What have I done? You have taught things that are contrary to Roman Catholic doctrine. Like what? Indulgences, for example. You're questioning indulgences, and the Pope has clearly decreed in favor of indulgences, and the cardinal quotes from a papal decree concerning indulgences. And at this point, Martin Luther basically says to him, yeah, but it's not biblical. It's not in the Bible. In essence, he's saying to this cardinal, I don't care that what the Pope said, and this is a Roman Catholic guy, the Protestant Reformation hasn't begun yet per se, but he says to this man, even though I understand that the Pope said that, but really I don't care, because it's not biblical. So now he is placing scripture above declarations of the Pope, which was a massive problem to the Roman Catholic Church. Let's move ahead another year. Luther got his famous debate, a massive debate, with the greatest debater of the Roman Catholic Church, at least the greatest debater in Germany, and his name was Johann Eck. And Johann Eck was an incredibly educated, well-known, very clever, great memory, very smart, had a voice that was louder than everyone, and he could just destroy all his opponents in debate. And so now he is debating Martin Luther. And as they're discussing some of these things that Martin Luther has been teaching concerning the authority of the Pope and indulgences and things like that, Johann Eck says, points out, that the things that Martin Luther is teaching are the same things that were taught by a man named Jan Hus 100 years earlier. Now, you may say, who is this man and why do I care about Jan Hus? Well, here's why Martin Luther cared and you should care. 100 years before Martin Luther, Jan Hus was a man who taught many similar things to Martin Luther. But what happened? The Roman Church held a council, condemned him as a heretic, and executed him. And now, here you have Martin Luther, who is teaching the same things that have been condemned as heresy by the Roman Catholic Church, by a council over 100 years ago. And Eck is saying to him, you're teaching the same things as Hus was teaching. And to everyone's shock and surprise, Martin Luther admitted, yes, I'm teaching the same things, which was, it just caused an outcry in the entire room because he was siding with a known heretic who was condemned and burned 100 years ago. And so now he is not only placing scripture above popes, he is also placing scripture above councils. At some point, as they're debating in Latin, Luther stops and he says, let me speak in German for a second because I'm afraid I may be misunderstood. So let me speak in German. And during the debate, he says, popes and councils have often contradicted one another. Therefore, we can see that they can make mistakes. And he made this statement. He said, a simple layman, that is just a non-expert, a simple layman armed with scripture is to be believed above popes and councils without scripture. This was radical teaching. He's basically saying any person here, a peasant who has scripture, has more authority than the Pope when the Pope is speaking without scripture. Now, obviously, these things did not go off very well. And so, a couple of years later, we reach the climax, we reach the great moment that you may already know, but I will remind you, where Martin Luther is brought before the princes of the church and before Charles V, who is the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, brought to stand before him. They bring him out and they have this table with Martin Luther's books and they say, Martin Luther, are you the author of these books? And he says, yes. And they say to him, do you recant from what you have written here? Now, there's a long discussion. This didn't take 5 minutes. I'm not going to tire you with the whole story. But the end of the discussion is this. They say to him, will you recant of these writings and these teachings? And his answer, the very famous answer, was, unless I am convinced by Holy Scripture or just common reason, and not by popes or councils that have so often contradicted one another, my conscience is captive to the Word of God. To go against conscience is neither right nor safe. Therefore, I cannot and I will not recant. Together with Martin Luther, Protestants, evangelicals, Baptists, whatever you want to call it, today, we declare that popes and councils do not determine the content of our faith. They do not determine our beliefs, but it is Scripture alone that is the infallible authority that we have in matters of faith and life. Now, I would like to show you one passage before we close, which changed my life 20 years ago. And I'm sure you know it, but it's always good to review. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Please turn there in your Bible. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Paul's second letter to Timothy is Paul's final letter. It's a letter he wrote before he was killed. He is writing it from prison to Timothy, who's on the outside. And Timothy, who used to be the student to the Apostle Paul, who would follow the Apostle Paul and learn from him, now Timothy is going to be left alone, so to speak, without his mentor, the Apostle Paul. And Timothy has to deal with false teachers in the church. How is he supposed to deal with them? What should he do when someone arises within the church teaching falsehoods, teaching things that are opposite to what God has said? Look at Paul's response. Look at Paul's answer. 2 Timothy chapter 3, let's start, say verse 13. He says, but evil men and imposters will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. He's speaking of the false teachers. But you, Timothy, in contrast to the deceivers and the evil men and the imposters that we just mentioned, but you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them. What is it that he has learned? And that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Now, listen to these statements. Verse 16. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Stop right there for a moment. He says all Scripture is theopneustos, is the word in Greek. Literally, God breathed. All Scripture is literally breathed out by God. What's the idea? The idea behind this is, you know how when you speak, what do? You take a breath in, and then you let the air out as you speak. Okay? You can't speak if you don't first take air in. That's why when you speak, you can feel the air on your hand, okay? That's, you speak and you breathe out. So the idea is this, that Scripture is the very speaking of God. It is God who has breathed out from His mouth the Scripture. And He's saying, since Scripture and all of Scripture is the Word of God and it's been breathed out by God, it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. If you have questions, if you're not sure about something, this is how you can be instructed. This is how you can be reproved and so forth. But here's the verse that changed my life. Verse 17. So you've spoken of all Scripture being inspired by God and being profitable, so that, verse 17, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. through Scripture, he says, the man of God. And when he says man of God, that's not adras, that's anthropos. So that means the human being. So it's not specifically referring to men, speaking of both men and women. The person of God, the person who belongs to God, may be complete. Let me ask a question. If through Scripture I can be made complete, what else do I need to add? It's a pretty simple question. What else do I need to add if Scripture is enough to make me complete? Once you start adding things now, you're just convoluting the whole issue. Now you're just messing it up even more. You're just bringing confusion now. That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. If there is a good work that God wants you to do, the Bible thoroughly equips you in doing it. Let me give you an example. What's the date today? It's the end of July, right? Did you know, according to Greek Orthodox theology, right now you should be fasting? Why? Because on the 15th of August, which is the great Marian holiday, the death and assumption of Mary, for 40 days before that, you're supposed to be fasting, according to the Greek Orthodox Church. Okay? So, here's a question. Next time a Roman Catholic or a Greek Orthodox person says to you, why aren't you doing this, something, anything? You reply, is that a good work? Is that a good work that God requires of me to do? They will say, of course, it's a good work that you're expected to do. Okay, all right. If it's a good work that God wants me to do, show me where Scripture equips me thoroughly to do it. Where? Because Paul says that Scripture can equip you thoroughly unto every good work. These are the kind of passages that bring us to the doctrine of sola scriptura. This is what Paul is talking about. The Bible is our ultimate authority in matters of faith and life. Doesn't mean that we have to ignore everything that has come before us, but we have to examine everything in light of Scripture. And by the way, the doctrine of sola scriptura is condemned by the Roman Catholic Church and the Greek Orthodox Church. Sola scriptura is condemned officially. According to the Roman Catholic Church and Greek Orthodox Church, you are a heretic if you believe such things. We'll let them say what they want. We believe that the Bible is our ultimate authority. Let me close. I'll close with this. I had a conversation a few years back with a gentleman who was a Greek Orthodox theologian. Yes. And he was telling me the Greek Orthodox Church is the church. It is the one true church of Christ for the past 2,000 years. Okay, I know that's what they tell you again and again and again. And so I said to him, you know, the Roman Catholic Church says the same thing. Are they the one true church of Jesus Christ for the past 2,000 years? He said, no. He said, no. We are, they are not. I said, okay. I said, here's a question that I have. Let's say that I'm an outsider, and I am looking for the one true church that teaches the one true gospel. And I go to the Greek Orthodox Church, and you say to me, we're the one true church, okay? And then I go to the Roman Catholics, and they say, no, we're the one true church, okay? I go to the Greek Orthodox, and they say, well, we have 2,000 years of being able to show that we can trace our way all the way back to the apostles. And I'm like, okay. And then I go to the Roman Catholics and they say, no, we're the ones who can trace our way all the way back to the apostles. I'm like, okay. And the Greek Orthodox say, well, we're the true church because we have all the right traditions. And then I go here and they say, no, we're the true church because we have all the right traditions. And so I ask this man, how can I, as an outsider, determine which one is the right one? How can I determine which one is the true church? Because they're both saying that they're the one, and all their argumentations are the same. And he didn't have an answer. Why? Because in order for me to be able to determine which one is the true church and which one teaches the true gospel, there has to be something above them that determines truth. There has to be a standard of truth above the churches that determines who is speaking the truth. There has to be an absolute truth that we follow in order to determine who down here is speaking the truth. And that absolute truth and standard, which does not change, is the Word of God. That's what we're saying. And we have to examine the Word of God to see who is speaking the truth and who is giving us the gospel correctly, and not simply saying, well, it's us. Why you? Well, because we say so. No, there has to be something above all of us, and there is. The Word of God, the Scriptures. That is our ultimate authority. That is our only infallible and inerrant authority, and that is the doctrine of sola scriptura. Over the next four Sundays, we will examine salvation much closer and talk about the other four solas. Thank you for your attention. Let's pray.